When light travels through a single medium, it tends to travel in a straight line. However, when traveling from one medium into another, light deviates from a straight line propagation. Using water as a second medium, the behavior of light will be studied as it passes from air and into water. Initially, the ray of light strikes the boundary between the two media at a right angle. It is observed that the light seems to be unaffected as it continues to travel in a straight line. However, if the light strikes the surface of the water at a glancing angle, it experiences a change in direction upon entering the water. This bending of light at the boundary between two different materials is called refraction. The angle at which the light strikes the boundary is measured relative to an imaginary line which is drawn perpendicular, or normal, to the surface. This angle is called the angle of incidence. The angle of refraction is also measured relative to the same normal line. As the angle of incidence is increased, it can be observed that the amount of bending also increases, as seen by the fact that the angle of refraction differs more and more from the angle of incidence. In traveling from air to water, it can be observed that the light bends toward the normal. With the speed of light 25% slower in water than in air, one can conclude that light will bend toward the normal when going from a fast medium to one in which it travels slower. If the direction of the light is reversed so that it first travels in water and then into air, the result is somewhat different. Here the light refracts in such a way that it bends away from the normal. One can conclude that in going from a slow medium to one in which it travels faster, light will bend away from the normal. Upon striking the boundary between the water and air, it can be observed that the light is divided into a refracted ray and a reflected ray. Initially, the refracted beam is of relatively strong intensity, and the reflected beam is of relatively weak intensity. As the angle of incidence is increased, the refracted beam is observed to become weaker in intensity as the reflected beam becomes stronger. Eventually, a situation is reached in which the refracted ray points along the surface, the angle of refraction being 90 degrees. If the angle of incidence is increased further, it is observed that the refracted beam disappears altogether, as all of the light energy is now in the reflected beam. This phenomenon is called total internal reflection. The incident angle that causes the refracted ray to lie along the boundary between the two materials is known as the critical angle. For light traveling from water to air, the critical angle is found to be approximately 49 degrees. For angles of incidence larger than the critical angle, the light is no longer able to escape from the water medium. The boundary between the two transparent materials acts like a most perfect mirror as the light is totally reflected. It should be noted that total internal reflection only occurs when light originates in the slower velocity medium. Refraction occurs whenever there is any change in the index of refraction. When there is an abrupt change, as at the surface of glass, the change in direction of the light is also abrupt. But when the change in the index of refraction is gradual, as for sunlight traveling through the Earth's atmosphere, the bending is of a different nature. In order to simulate the refraction which takes place when sunlight passes through the Earth's atmosphere, a solution with a gradually changing index of refraction will be prepared. Warm water is first poured into the tank. Next, a concentrated sugar solution is added. By pouring the sugar solution down through a glass tube, mixing with the pure water is kept to a minimum. The more dense sugar solution tends to settle on the bottom, with the less dense warm water remaining on top. Some mixing does occur, which establishes a gradually changing sugar concentration from the bottom to the top of the solution. This creates a vertical gradient of index of refraction, similar to that of the Earth's atmosphere. If a beam of light enters the solution on a nearly horizontal path, the refraction which takes place within the solution is not at all abrupt, but rather, the smooth variation in the index of refraction causes a smooth change in the wave direction, and the light ray is observed to bend in a gentle curve. Because light travels more slowly through the denser regions where the sugar concentration is higher, the light beam encounters a gradual increase in the index of refraction as it travels into the lower regions of the solution. For this reason, the light gradually bends downward or toward the normal. The Earth's atmosphere has refractive properties which are very similar to those of the variable sugar solution. The density of the atmosphere is greatest at the Earth's surface and gradually decreases as one goes to higher altitudes. Light traveling from the vacuum of space into the Earth's atmosphere is gradually slowed down and refracted as it encounters an increasingly denser atmosphere. Refraction does not take place at a single point, but occurs continuously as light travels through the atmosphere. Because of atmospheric refraction, the sun can be seen for several minutes after it has actually set below the horizon. If the beam of light enters the solution from the bottom so that it first passes through the more concentrated portion of the sugar solution, the light is once again observed to follow a curved path. After initially traveling upward, bending takes place to such a degree that the light is made to curve back downward. Originating in an area where the index of refraction is relatively large, the upward directed light passes through solution of increasingly lower index of refraction. In so doing, the light is gradually refracted downward away from the normal. When light encounters many isolated small particles, the particles absorb some of the light and re-emit it. However, the scattering is selective for particular wavelengths. It is this selective scattering which causes our sky to be blue and sunsets to be red. In order to demonstrate the process by which the sky is made to be blue and sunsets made to be red, a large spherical container of water and an intense source of white light will be used. If the light source is allowed to pass through the water, all the wavelengths making up the white light pass straight through, and no separation of color is observed. If a mixture of cedarwood oil and alcohol is added to the water, a suspension of very small particles is formed. The suspended particles are much smaller than the wavelength of visible light. If white light is passed through the newly formed suspension, light of a blue color is observed to come from the side of the container. The light which is transmitted through the suspension is observed to be of a yellow-orange color. The interaction of light waves with the small particles is in fact responsible for the observed result. This phenomenon is called Rayleigh scattering, and occurs whenever the scattering particles are much smaller than the incident wavelength. If the setup is observed from different angles, it can be seen that blue light is scattered at right angles relative to the direction in which the light is traveling. Beyond 90 degrees, the blue light diminishes, and the wavelengths closer to the red end of the visible spectrum become increasingly predominant. The light from the red end of the spectrum, which has managed to pass straight through the suspension, has not been strongly scattered. Thus, light in the visible spectrum is selectively scattered, with the light at the blue end of the spectrum being scattered about 10 times more than light at the red end. If an additional amount of cedarwood oil and alcohol is added to the water, the number of scattering particles is increased. With the light encountering a greater number of particles, the amount of blue light which is scattered at right angles becomes greater. The light which passes through the suspension is observed to become more reddish in color, as more of the shorter wavelengths from the blue end of the spectrum have been removed by scattering. The sky's blue color is due to Rayleigh scattering. Light reaching our eyes from the sky is sunlight that has been scattered by the air molecules and is therefore predominantly blue. Molecules of oxygen and nitrogen are the most effective scattering agents in the atmosphere, being less than 1,000th the size of a wavelength of blue light. When the sun is on the horizon, the sunlight must travel a much greater distance through the atmosphere than when the sun is overhead. This results in a greater number of scattering centers, which remove more and more of the blue end of the spectrum, leaving the setting sun with a reddish color.